One of those senators who voted today to change the Marriage Act is Senator James Paterson, who, of course, is a Liberal senator for Victoria, who tried his best to introduce changes to the legislation and to, in fact, introduce his own bill. He's joined us on the line. Senator, thanks for your time.
Great to be with you, Steve and Andrew.
You voted yes?
I did. I voted yes in the survey and I voted yes in the chamber today. But despite my support for same-sex marriage, I also support the freedoms of all other Australians, their right to freedom of speech, their right to freedom of conscience, their right to freedom of religion. And that's why I fought very hard to protect those in the bill.
Is there any option now open to you to get any of those safeguards introduced into this legislation, or is it too late? This goes through. Can it happen in the lower house?
There are two opportunities. One is in the lower house, where I believe at least some of the amendments that I moved that were based on the bill that I released will also be moved in the house, and hopefully they fare better there than they did in the Senate. The second way they could be dealt with is with the upcoming Ruddock review, which is going to look into religious freedom in a more general way, and will be reporting back to the government in the new year. I hope that that will have a series of recommendations about how religious freedom can be better protected, and I hope that the government will take them up, and I hope that the parliament will support them, but obviously that there's a lot of steps in that process before we get to a successful outcome.
Well, may I congratulate you, James, on fighting so hard for freedom of speech and religion. It's an unpopular cause, unfortunately, and remarkably. You copped
Shouldn't
a lot
be.
Of very personal abuse there, which I thought was really unfortunate, including from people I normally respect. I thought that was really off, and I know that would have hurt you, and I congratulate you. Can you explain to me why your attempts and those of others to raise this were voted against last night by five fellow Liberal senators and one National Party senator? Why did they sell you out on this issue?
Well, thank you, Andrew, and you're right. It sometimes is unpopular to stand up for minorities. You can stand up for minorities as they used to be, people who wanted to get married and who were gay, and you can stand up for people who are minorities today who just want to be able to continue to hold their beliefs freely without persecution, and you can be unpopular both times, I've discovered. It's difficult for me to explain the reasons why other people decided to vote the way they did. As you know, the coalition parties had a free vote on these amendments and on the bill, and every coalition member had to come to their own decision and justify with their own conscience how they voted.
Yeah, but what would kill them to make a stand for free speech or for freedom of religion? What's the harm here?
Well, I'm not the best person to explain their rationale because I obviously disagree with it, and some of them explained their rationale and others did not. But one fact that we really should not lose sight of and we should not let off the hook here is that the Labor Party said they were going to have a conscience vote. In fact, they complained bitterly that the Liberal Party previously was not going to have a conscience vote, and yet in the end, every Labor senator voted against every amendment, despite the fact that we know there were a number of them who wanted to vote with us and vote for stronger protection.
Well,
they effectively weren't allowed to.
But for me, I agree with you, and you're absolutely correct. But for me, this makes the six coalition MPs who voted against these freedoms even more culpable. Because if you know that one side of the debate has got a free vote, meaning some people will vote on the other side, whereas the Labor side has not got a free vote, so there won't be a reciprocal leaking of votes to you, then surely that makes it even more imperative that you hold the line. And instead, they facilitated a decision which may well be a minority decision. We do not know.
I think it's really regrettable, Andrew. And I guess one thing I would say in defence of my colleagues who made a different decision that I did is that we actually only discovered what the Labor Party's position was on amendments very, very late in the piece.
Yeah, not too late, not too late. Look, you're being too kind, James. Can I just ask, this goes to a further point. We see so much, to be honest, to be perfectly blunt, it's generating into a rabble, particularly, you've now got four National MPs saying they'll cross the floor with Labor and the Greens to impose a commission into banking that the government's been opposed to. You've got two National MPs today accusing the Prime Minister of not showing any leadership at all on this issue, by the way. It's just terrible. And I just wonder, talking about the Liberals in particular, when you've got such deep divisions on something as fairly fundamental, I would have thought, as freedom of speech or freedom of religion in the Liberal Party, is the Liberal Party now so broad that nobody can unite it?
Well, I understand why some of our supporters are very frustrated, Andrew, when they watch debates like this and the way that they unfold. And I certainly agree with them that it has been messy and not as tidy as we would have liked it to be. But one thing they can take great comfort from is that the vast majority, the overwhelming majority of coalition senators voted in favour of every single amendment that was put to increase the protections for freedoms. Now, some chose not to, but the vast bulk did. So they can feel at least that the majority of coalition senators represent them, their interests and their concerns.
Yeah, but my point still is you had quite a few that did not. And is the Liberal Party now so broad that you're heading to a split? Is it ungovernable? I mean, for instance, imagine Tony Abbott coming back. You know that the party will be undermining, the number of ministers and backbenchers will undermine him like a shot tomorrow, the leaking and everything going on. I just wonder whether it's just now ungovernable being so ideologically broad now.
I think there are a lot of lessons from the last few years, from this era of our time in government, and I hope it continues for many more years to come. But if it does not, I think it's important that we learn the right lessons from it. One of the things I think is important is that we need to show more loyalty to each other. We need to support each other. And when we disagree, we need to do so in a better and more manageable way than we have in recent years, because I agree it has been messy and disconcerting, particularly for our supporters.
Very diplomatic of you, James, just before you go.
He's the youngest bloke in Parliament. He speaks more adult than the rest of them.
Far too.
Sorry about that, mate.
No,
but
he's far too.
Patronising.
He's far too diplomatic for us, Andrew.
Yeah,
Dastyari, should they get rid of him?
Sam Dastyari is a danger to Australia's national security. And if we didn't already know that, the further revelations tonight are yet more evidence of it. What on earth was he thinking when he went to meet someone who he knew was a person of interest through media reports for our security agencies and perhaps the security agencies of other countries, and asked him to have a private meeting with him outside his home where they left their mobile phones inside his home? I mean, this is scandalous behaviour. And Bill Shorten said today that that Sam Dastyari had one more chance, and this afternoon I think Sam Dastyari blew that last chance.
Thank you for your time. Appreciate it very much.
Thanks, Steve. Thanks, Andrew.
Senator James Paterson there. See, we just had to wait a little bit, be patient, Andrew, for him to throw a hand.